Thomas Isaiah Grom. Okay. All right, let's get this. All right, we were talking about the adipose system and development of adipose cells. Okay, we had mentioned the fact that we put on fat cells during months 8 and 9 prenatally, and then in between month birth and month 6. So those are kind of rapid adipose growth, and then when we hit puberty, right? So body fat, so body fat changes as we grow. So where we're laying it down is different at different points, right? Children start off with more internal, so visceral around their organs than they do. So people that are typically developing healthy 7-year-old, their legs and their arms are quite thin, right? Most of their weight is around their tummy, internal, and it's one of the indicators. You see a child that's got kind of chubby arms and legs at that age, then they could be at risk for overweight or obesity, right? So from about 6 or 7, they start to lay down some more subcutaneous fat, peripheral, under the skin, and they start to pad out until they're into puberty. Boys put more on their trunk. Girls put more fat on all over their body, but particularly their legs and around their hips. And when we are looking post-puberty, we still see girls increasing in subcutaneous fat, right? So part of that, when you compare teenage populations, part of that is because girls are less active than boys at any age, right? But particularly when we're looking at teenagers. And so that plays a role in the fact that we see increase in subcutaneous fat even after they've had this pubertal spurt, right? Remember that most of our fat growth is hypertrophy, not hyperplasia, although during puberty we see some hyperplasia, we put down those extra cells. But after puberty, what we see when people gain weight is typically hypertrophy, right? I'm filling up those fat cells. It takes a lot to lay down extra cells as an adult. I've got to really swing the balance on my calorie intake and my calorie output to put down extra cells, right? And it's significant because those cells don't go away. So once they're there for good. That makes it much easier then to put weight on than it would be if they weren't available, right? Once I've built them, they persist through life. So if I look at my old S-curve that we talked about at the beginning, right? We said that regardless of whether we were looking at height or weight, we had rapid, kind of steady, rapid at puberty, and then we should reach maturity. This is very true if I'm measuring height, right? Your height is very stable as an adult until you're old and then it goes down a little bit, right? It should be stable when we look at weight, but actually what we see is something that's much more variable, right, depending upon our lifestyle and what we choose to do. When we get to leaving college and going out to work, the average picture is increasing, right? So we get a lot of yo-yo dieting going on average between the age of 20, 21, when you're kind of done with school, you might go to college or you might go straight out to work. And for girls, they put on about 26 pounds between that age and about 50, right? On average. So again, you guys are not going to be the average population. You're very atypical of your generation. For guys, it's about 18 pounds that they put on between 20s and 50s. So a little bit less than for girls. Remember, estrogen makes it easier for girls to put on fat mass than for boys. Right? It's actually a little bit harder for guys to put on fat mass. Once we hit 50 though, we see some interesting trends. Again, on average, the trend is that weight goes down a little bit the older I get, but it's going down because I'm decreasing in bone mass and in muscle mass, not because I'm decreasing in my fat mass. Okay? So, a personal example about how difficult this is. I'm relatively active. I'm not as active as I should be, but I'm pretty active for my age, right? About 3 years ago, I was exactly the same weight on the scale, but my body fat percentage was about 19, right? Now I'm exactly the same weight as I was 3 years ago, which is pretty good. Quite pleased with that, except now my body fat is 21%, which means I probably actually put on a little bit of fat mass, but I've lost quite a lot of muscle mass, even though I'm active, right? Because I'm not active enough. It's really hard when we look at this data about older adults. It's very easy to sit back and say, well, they should just be more active. But it's actually very difficult to, you've got to be a lot more active, right? You don't just get to kind of coast. I've been active all my life, I've got all these muscles, I'm really strong, I hit 50 or 60, now I can coast. That's not how it works. You have to keep being pretty active to maintain muscle mass. So that's an important idea for you to take to your parents and your aunts and uncles and things. Try to say to them, you know, we should go out and move at the weekend. Let's go to the park and play ball, or let's go for a bike ride. Because it's really, really hard to make the time to do enough work to stay what we know is healthy. As we get older, trunk fat becomes more noticeable. So we tend to put on our weight around our waists or on our tummies. Okay? No, that's the other class. I don't think I've had that conversation with you. Type 2 diabetes is much more highly linked to fat that is laid down around your stomach than it is to fat that is on your arms or legs. So the older you get and the more of this fat you lay down around your middle, the greater your health risk becomes. So there's a lot of reasons for paying attention to what shape, what's happening with my shape. Where is the weight going if I'm putting on weight? Right? So larger waists, smaller arms and legs means I'm at more health risk, but also biomechanically makes me less stable. All right, so imagine, you'll notice when with pregnant ladies, right, less stable. Same with people who carry a lot of their weight here. All right, think about what we said about base of support. Right? When I put on weight, my feet don't grow. So my base of support remains the same size. But now I've got this additional weight that shifts my center of gravity forwards and pushes it much closer to the edge of my base of support. Does that make sense? So if you look at that from the side,
that's why they have a lot of back knee problems.
Yes. Yeah.
And arthritis.
Because there's extra weight pulling on their spine, and their knees have got this extra weight that they're having to deal with. If you look at it from the side, right, then here's my center of gravity, say, right? And here's my base of support. So I've got a nice wobble space there before I fall over. Does that make sense? But if I put on this additional weight around my middle, then now what I do, right, so I put on this weight, it shifts my center of gravity here, and now look how much wobble room I've got. Not very much. So it makes me much less stable, much more likely to fall over. Subconsciously, then, your brain is going to change your movement pattern to try to keep you stable, because falling over is a bad thing. So one of the things we see is movement patterns change as we put on weight. So they might take a shorter step, or if you're throwing them a ball, they might take a wider stance than they would have done, because this is more stable than this, right?
You also, an older person with like that wobbling or whatever, they have a bigger risk of falling at an older age.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Because the older you get, once this is here, the harder it is then to lose it and get set in and get healthy again. And as you get older, your legs are getting weaker, so your ability to pull yourself back when you're off balance gets lower. So it can be quite a big problem there. Okay, if we remain active, if we can keep our elderly population and our older population active, then we see less increase in fat mass, not none, right? But less than we would do if we weren't active. So it's really important that we get parents, aunts and uncles, cousins, who make sure that they don't kind of sit back on their laurels, that they keep moving. All right, last system. In between the adipose system and the nervous system in the textbook is a lot of information on the endocrine system, which is fascinating, but unnecessary for us, for class, all right? Because there's just not time to do everything that's available. So you can skip that portion, chapter 5, right? But we do want to take a quick look at the nervous system. So our inherited genes are hardwired to drive the initial development of the nervous system, right? So our genes direct the growth of the structure. How do the cells grow? How do the cells connect to each other, right? And they direct the main circuitry. So where is the central nervous system talking to itself? But what we know from the brain research is that extrinsic factors play a large influence. Once those cells are down, what happens and how they talk to each other becomes more and more influenced by outside. Right? So connections between one part of the cell and another part, or two cells that are next door to each other, called synaptic connections, that development can be influenced greatly by the environment that the child grows up in. There's trillions of these synaptic connections in the nervous system. Okay? And we fine-tune them with experience. So in lab, we had that article that you read on the windows of opportunity. This is what we're talking about, right? Can I create synaptic connections that encourage good motor patterns, or do we not give children that opportunity and make it harder for them to learn good motor patterns?
Is that kind of like muscle memory?
Kind of. Muscle memory is a bit of a misnomer. What happens is your brain learns a skill so well that after injury or after sickness or after you haven't done the skill for a long time, it can still recall that skill if it had enough experience at it. So it looks like muscle memory because you can do it and your arms and legs are in the right place, but really it's locating the right motor pattern. Muscles do grow back faster once you've trained them. So if you do a lot of weight work and then you're sick or you take a couple of months off after the summer, when you come back and you do your weight work, you get stronger faster. But again, it's memory's kind of the wrong word for it, in my opinion. So prenatally, the cells migrate, they're going to, if they're switched on to be nerve cells, then they'll develop a central body and they'll develop dendrites and all the things that we see in a nerve cell. They differentiate. Right, they'll migrate to a certain place. Different nerve cells look slightly different depending on what their job is. They all have the same main components, but some of them have very, very long axons. Some of them have very, very short axons. Some of them have big round cell bodies. Some of them have little, tiny cell bodies. Right? So they'll migrate and start to develop the type of axon and dendrite and things, bless you, that they need to do the particular job. So we make about 200 billion. By the time we're born, we have about 100 billion or so nerve cells. So we overproduce them initially in prenatal scenario, and then we prune them back, right? And then by about month six, they're starting to carry signals. So we don't see, for example, if you know anyone who's pregnant and they're only at month three or four, there's no baby kicking, right? Baby can't kick because the nervous system is not in place or switched on yet, right? So part of what makes the first kick exciting is that it indicates that the nervous system is triggering and working typically.
What month will you see the first kick?
I think it's around 6.5 to 7, but I'm not absolutely certain because I've never done that. I'm stuck with pussycats. but I think it's 6.5, 7 months. Teratogens that we talked about briefly could be one of the things that disturb where the cells end up or how they branch off and talk to each other. All right, so one of the problems with having exposure to certain teratogens is it can disturb development of the nervous system for the baby. Postnatally, though, we see lots of change, but most of it is in the connections, not in new nerve cells. So when we're born, the brain is about 25% of its adult weight. By about 4 years old, it's about 80% of its adult weight. So a huge amount of change went on between birth and 4 years old, but it isn't the new nerve cells, it's all the linking, all the wiring, all the talking to each other that makes the cell bigger over those 4 years. So the more experiences we expose that child to, the more wiring, the more talking to each other that goes on. So we can make the size of the nerve cells bigger, hypertrophy, if we give them stimulus, right? We get these massive synaptic connections going on, our windows of opportunity. We increase glial cells, they're support cells. So they're the things that are available in the brain and the spinal cord for the, that provide nutrition. They store glucose, provide nutrition, and we start to see rapid myelination, fatty cells wrapped around certain nerve axons. In the motor nerves, all motor nerves have myelination. It speeds up how quickly the signal can get from the brain down the nerve cell. Right, that fatty sheath speeds it up, can be up to 150 times faster than in a nerve cell that doesn't have myelination around its axon. Right, that's a good thing because I don't want that signal from my brain, right, my motor cortex is around here, and I have to be able to wiggle my big toe. I don't want it to take 3 days for the signal to get down there to wiggle my big toe, right? So being able to move the signal faster down certain types of nerves is very useful. So the more learning, the more stimulus we can provide, the increase in the number of synaptic connections we see. At about the age of 9 or 10, the brain will start pruning away these synaptic connections that it doesn't use. So if we don't speak a second language, if we don't do a lot of movement skills, then we start to prune off those things that aren't getting used. And I can put them back, but it's harder the next time. Right? I can still learn a second language, I can make these connections in my brain, but it's way, way harder than it would have been before I pruned them out. So across the lifespan, what we see with these synaptic connections is constant change, depending upon what experiences I'm getting. It's also great when you look at the older adult literature, because I can still make new synapses when I'm older. So if I'm 80 and I want to take a class, I can still learn content in a class because I can make new connections. It's slower, right? But I can. I can keep myself engaged and stimulated. So learning then becomes an extrinsic factor. It's like an environmental constraint that changes my motor behavior and drives development of the nervous system. When we look at functional magnetic resonance images, fMRI, you can actually see, they're really cool. You can get pictures through fMRI where you give someone something to read or a picture to look at, and a certain part of their brain lights up on the fMRI. And then you give them something different to do, and a completely different part of the brain lights up. And then if you add movement, these two parts of the brain talk to the motor cortex. It's very, very cool. Very cool. Right? So the more we do it, the more synapses, the easier it becomes to repeat it.
Really?
As we get older, right, then just aging, just chronological aging means it gets harder to do these things, right? We see some breaks in the synaptic links, or if we have an injury, we might have to create new links that take along the route that slow us down. We start to see the breakdown of the myelin sheath. So from a motor perspective, when we look at the motor nerve, that signal that could travel very, very quickly now travels more slowly. It's not that the signal's not going and it isn't going to get there, but it takes longer, and so the response to something is longer, which has some social and lifestyle implications, because we don't stop people from driving. It would be very difficult in this country, in certain areas of this country, for an older adult to be independent if they weren't allowed to drive. And yet we know that their speed of how quickly they can move if something happens gets slower and slower, even though they keep practicing. The good thing is they've got so much experience. If they're paying attention, they can anticipate something that might happen and kind of be one step ahead. But what if they're not paying attention? Right? What if they've got their grandbaby in the car and they're trying to keep the grandbaby engaged so that it's not screaming its head off? Right? Or they're not feeling very well. So one of the things we know is that the more exercise we do, the less decline in cognitive function we see. Not no decline, unfortunately, right? If I exercise every day until I die, I'm not gonna be just as smart and just as quick and witty as I am now. So, all right? There's going to be decline, but the decline is less if I keep moving. So, questions? Right? Look at the idea of myelination, because that's pretty crucial when we're talking about movement and the motor system. If you know anyone who has multiple sclerosis, one of the problems with multiple sclerosis is that the myelin sheath either does not form correctly or is breaking down at a different rate. And so when you watch people with multiple sclerosis as it develops, as they get older, their movements become a little bit jerky and less coordinated because the speed of the signal is all messed up. And so they might contract their bicep, but the speed of the signal to their hands is slower. And so everything sort of happens in pieces. It's quite an interesting thing to watch, although it's a ghastly disease to develop. What does that mean to our children? We said that myelination develops over time. So when I watch a two-year-old or a three-year-old move, they actually look quite different to a 5, 6, and 7-year-old, because in between, that myelination has spread down the motor nerve, and so the signals are getting down to the muscles quicker So their ability to do things in a more appropriate, more coordinated fashion in response to a signal gets better as that myelination gets completed. Right? We're not born with it, it develops over time. So by about four or so, four and a half, you see quite a drastic change in their movement. Quite interesting here, because we get them up to about five, you start to see the change, and then they go to kindergarten, and then you bump into them about a year later in Walmart, and they're like completely different. I mean, the way they're moving is completely different a year later. So that can be very interesting to watch. Okay, questions? All right, what time do we have? Okay, it's 11:30. Let's just take 10 minutes to practice our MSU chart idea, okay? So what I would like you to do is get into, I've got two balls, I've got, so we want four skills. I want you to do catching, kicking, long jump, and galloping, all right, off your MSU chart. Get with a group, and I want you just to role play the characteristics for each stage, so that you can start to see what those stages look like as the skill develops. All right, so you can jump over the hoop, you can gallop out in the corridor, jump in the corner, you can jump down here probably. It is, isn't it? One of my grad students gave it to me. I'm very excited. And then we've got ball for kicking, and we've got a ball for catching, all right? So just spend a few minutes just playing with that chart so that you're starting to get an idea of what the skills look like on your chart.
Yeah, I'm working out. back running, trying to control the kid.
Wednesday's class is your review. So if you've got any questions of anything that you want me to go over before we start the review activities, let me know. Friday is your exam. Yes, sir. Sorry?
Yeah.
Why don't you guys want to study for a test next Wednesday?
Is it Friday?
No, the last test.